This morning's speaker is Miguel De La Torre. And let me tell you a little bit about Dr. De La Torre. His academic pursuit is social ethics within contemporary US thought, specifically how religion affects race, class, and gender oppression. Since obtaining his doctoral degree in 1999, he has authored over 100 articles and published 41 books, five of which have won national awards. As an academic myself, I can tell you that this is a head-spinning number of publications. He presently serves as the professor of social ethics and Latinx studies at the Iliff School of Theology in Denver. He's been a Fulbright scholar, and he's taught in Indonesia, Mexico, South Africa, Costa Rica, Cuba, and Germany. He served as the 2012 president of the Society of Christian Ethics. He's the recipient of the 2020 American Academy of Religion's Excellence in Teaching Award, and the 2021 Martin E. Marty Public Understanding of Religion Award. He served as past director to the American Academy of Religion and on its editorial board. Additionally, he was the co-founder and executive director of the Society of Race, Ethnicity, and Religion, and the founding editor of the Journal of Race, Ethnicity, and Religion. A scholar and activist, Dr. De La Torre has written numerous articles in popular media and has served on as several civic organizations. Recently, he wrote the screenplay. He's got many talents. To a documentary on immigration called Trails of Hope and Terror. That documentary won several awards. The title of his talk for us this morning is Why We Come, Rethinking Our Immigration Crises. Welcome, Dr. De La Torre.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Buenos dias, you all. So glad to be virtually in New York, my hometown. I grew up in Manhattan and in Queens. So I'm very honored and very happy to be back. It was June 21st, 1960, when I received a letter from the US government, specifically stating that I was in violation of Section 242 of the Immigration and Nationality Act. In other words, I overstayed my tourist visa. The letter went on to say that I had to self-deport within the next 30 days. I did not. From that point on, I was what many like to call a illegal alien, a very insulting term because no human being can ever really be illegal. Now, the question that I want to wrestle with is, why was I here in the first place? Some would argue that I was coming looking for freedom. Others would argue that I came to suck up all the US generosity and the social services. Those two answers, quite frankly, are incorrect. The main reason that I am here has to do with bananas. So I want to begin by talking about why bananas caused my immigration in the first place. In 1870, Americans did not know what bananas were. The reason was there was no way of transporting it from tropical climates to the US. And by the time it got here, they were too overripe and could not be eaten. But then there was technological advancements in steamboats and in refrigeration. So by 1870, during the Chicago World Fair, they began to sell bananas or a slice of a banana for about a nickel in a little tin cup. And since Americans first tasted bananas, they literally went bananas over bananas. By 1899, over 16 million bushels a year of bananas were being sold within the United States. What happened then is that several individuals came together and created a company to provide bananas to the US. And that company came to be known as the United Fruit Company. And I want to use Guatemala as an example, but what goes on in Guatemala really goes on throughout the entire Caribbean. In 1901, the dictator, Manuel Estrada Carrera, gave the United Fruit Company free rein to grow bananas as a compensation. The United Fruit Company agreed to build its roads, to build ports, so they could transport the bananas to the U.S. The United States then began to support governments like Cabrera's throughout the Caribbean. And it was companies that basically would do the bidding for the United Fruit Company. This is what became known at the time as banana republics. And the idea was that these governments only existed to produce bananas along with any other fruits that the United Fruit Company grew at the time. And if the government decided to rebel against this arrangement, the US Marines were sent to calm down any rebellion and ensure that the government will remain in the pockets of the United Fruit Company. This is what Teddy Roosevelt called gunboat diplomacy. In other words, the Marines and the gunboats were at the service of US corporations to make sure that the business interests of those corporations were always met. And of course, during this time, the president of any of these countries was the second most powerful person within the country. The first most powerful person was always the US ambassador to that country. Now in 1950s, in Guatemala, 70% of the land was controlled by 2.2% of the population. 10% of the land was in the hands of 90% of the indigenous population. So there was definitely an unfairness as to who owned land. Jacobo Abanez ran for president in Guatemala under the promise that if elected, he would institute land reform and provide more land to the indigenous population. He won the election in an open democratic election. However, what he did was that when he was elected, he went ahead and said, we will buy back the land of the United Fruit Company at whatever price they claim the land was worth for tax purposes. As you can imagine, the United Fruit Company undervalued the land to pay less taxes. Now, the United Fruit Company was very upset with this. So they contacted two of their former attorneys to help them. These two attorneys were brothers. The last name was Dulles. And during the Eisenhower administration, one was the head of the State Department and the other one was the head of the CIA. What they did was they tapped the Guatemalan desk leader at the State Department to begin a campaign to overthrow the Guatemalan democratically elected government. The person in charge of this campaign, once it was over, ended up becoming the CEO of the United Fruit Company, interesting enough. But here's what's interesting. This would have been the second time the United States overthrew a democratically elected government. A few years earlier, they overthrew the Shah of Iran. And we all saw how well that worked out. So now in 1954, they decided to use that same plan in Guatemala. And what ended up happening was a 30-year civil war that devastated the country. And still to this day, the country is reeling from the effects of the war that occurred. So just to give you an idea of why I say this is just an example, throughout the 20th century, the United States invaded 21 countries in the Caribbean basin. 21 times the United States sent Marines to overthrow the government that was not playing by the rules that the United Fruit Company staged. That does not include the 26 covert CIA operations to overthrow governments throughout the Caribbean base. This means in the last century, 47 times the United States engaged in what Bush later on called regime change. That's one every other year we send Marines to overthrow a government. And we have to pause on those numbers for a second, because many of these governments were basically seeking just to determine their own sovereignty. And those numbers are startling. And here's the thing, Americans don't know this. I remember when I went to the Pentagon, as a tourist, there's a statue outside the Pentagon of the rising of the flag in Iwo Jima. And on the bottom of the on the pedestal of that statue is all the countries where the Marines have died. And I thought I knew my U.S. history. You know, we fought the Revolution, the War of 1812, the Mexican-American War, Civil War, Spanish-American War, First, Second World War, and Korea and Vietnam. But to my shock, I saw on that pedestal, Mexico, El Salvador, Guatemala, Nicaragua, all the countries in Latin America. And I was shocked because I did not know when we fought wars there that Marines would have died. And only now I'm beginning to realize we've been invading those countries every other year in the last century. So my own country, Cuba, was invaded by the United States two times, along with invaded four times, and two that we know of CIA operations to overthrow the government. So my own country experienced six attempts of the United States to impose regime change, which creates obviously a tremendous instability within the country. So I want to now focus on my country, Cuba, to explain why I'm here. In 1895, we were fighting our third war for independence from Spain. We and Puerto Rico were the last two colonies that Spain had. During 1895, we began to win the war. Literally, the Cuban rebel armies controlled all the countryside and basically all the major cities except Santiago de Cuba. At the time, Spain approached the United States to sell Cuba to the United States. McKinley decided not to because it would have been a lost cause. So instead, what happened was a battleship was sent to Havana and it blew up. We know now that it blew up because of the boiler system. Overheated, and this was very common for battleships during this time. But instead, the press said that it was Spanish spies who blew up the ship, giving the United States the excuse under the battle cry, "Remember the Maine," to join the fight, something that no Cuban rebel ever asked the United States to do. In fact, there was a lot of the rebels who then fought the United States when they entered into the fight. Within a month, the United States won the war. Teddy Roosevelt rode up some hill in San Juan and claimed victory, and the Spanish gave up. And here's the interesting thing. Whenever a colony liberates itself from the colonizer, you have this thing called the changing of the flag, and where the flag of the colonizer comes down and the flag of the new republic is raised. On the day that the Spaniards left Cuba, January 1st, 1899, the Americans prohibited any Cuban who fought in the rebel armies to enter the city of San Santiago that day in fear that the Cubans could not behave themselves and may create trouble. So when the Spanish flag came down, it was the stars and stripes that went up. And for the first time, the United States entered the colonial enterprise business. The Cuban War of Independence changed its name to the Spanish-American War, a war between two empires, a declining Spanish empire and an emerging US empire. Within 5 years of the US taking over, Americans owned 60% of all the rural land of Cuba that grew sugar. Therefore, 90% of all of our sugar and tobacco and rum, the three necessities of life, and our main crops were US bound. They were grown on US soil, on US owned land, transported on US owned trains to US owned ports, and placed on US ships to come to the United States. All the nickel, our main mineral, was owned by the US. 50% of all our oil refineries were US owned, the rest were owned by the British and the Dutch. And the United States agreed to finally leave Cuba, get its troops out of Cuba, only if Cuba was to sign the Platt Amendment. Senator Platt at the time created this amendment that had to be included in the Cuban Constitution before the United States troops were taken out of Cuba. And the amendment basically says that the US has the right to intervene militarily into Cuba anytime Cubans are unable to govern themselves, that any treaty that Cuba signs with any other country must be approved first by the US and give the US better terms, and that the Cuban government must give up land, specifically a piece of land in Guantanamo Bay, to the US to own as a military operation base. So basically, Cuba became a vassal of the US to the point that until the Cuban Revolution of 1958, US dollars were used as the currency in Cuba, with equal value. Now, I want to go further back in history for a moment and look at what was called manifest destiny. This was a religious term created in the 1930s that basically stated that God gave white Americans this land as their promised land, just like God once gave the Hebrews the land which would become Israel. There only was one problem with manifest destiny. People were actually living on the land. So obviously, just like the Israelites and the Canaanites, those people were meant to be exterminated. But not only was there the extermination of the indigenous people, there was also another country in the way, Spain. So basically the United States could not go further west because Spain already claimed the land, which they stole themselves from the Indians. So James Polk ran for president, and Polk ran on the campaign promise that if he is elected president, he would implement manifest destiny and invade Mexico and take the land. Polk was elected, and within a month, he sends troops across the Mexican border. And when he does that, Mexican soldiers see the troops invading their nation, and he goes and they go ahead and responds with fire. This gives Polk the opportunity to go to Congress and demand a declaration of war. When he does that, at the time, there is an ex-president, John Quincy Adams, who was now a representative in Congress. And in his memoir, and Quincy Adams stands up at the floor of the House of Representatives and makes a speech in where he says, and I'm pretty much quoting from memory, "I fear today that the banners of our republic will become the banners of tyranny for what we're about to do to Mexico. One of the soldiers, a lieutenant who fought during the Mexican-American War, was an individual called Ulysses S. Grant, who eventually became president. In the 1880s, when he's dying of throat cancer, he writes his memoirs. And in his memoirs, he reflects at during this time of the Mexican-American War. And he writes in his memoirs, and again, I'm pretty much quoting from memory, just as God punishes individuals for their sins, God probably punished our sovereign nation with the Civil War for what we did to Mexico. So in Grant's mind, this was divine justice. The Civil War was divine justice for the injustice that we did to Mexico. Now I say all this to say that there was this understanding that what we were doing was an invasion. And here's the funny thing. When we were getting ready to invade Iraq, at the time, Secretary of State Colin Powell gives this speech at the United Nations, in where he says, our nation has never invaded another nation for the purpose of land, but we just ask for enough land to bury our dead. And of course, the ambassador of Mexico just cracked up laughing, because the invasion of Mexico meant the acquisition of the entire southwestern United States. And it wasn't the land that was acquired. It was also the gold of California, the silver of Nevada, the oil of Texas, all the natural harbors along the California coast, the copper of Arizona and New Mexico. In short, this became the seed money that went ahead and unleashed the Industrial Revolution. If it wasn't for the invasion of Mexico and the taking of their land and minerals, the United States would not have been able to emerge as the empire that it did during the early 20th century. So, as I say all this, we could probably say, well, you know, that was bad, you know, it was horrible. Thank God we don't do that kind of stuff anymore. Let's talk about NAFTA. While before we used to invade other people to take their land, the indigenous people at first, Mexicans second, with the Spanish-American War, we changed from acquiring land to instead acquiring economies. It was more profitable to control another people's economy than it was the headache of controlling their land and their government, especially when we saw the other people as inferior. There was many articles during the early 1900s about, we do not want to take over Cuba because those are an inferior Mongol people who are barbarians and savages, and we want nothing to have them polluting our republic with their bad eugenic genes. So rather than taking in these inferior people, it was more profitable to take over their economy. So one of the ways we did this, especially in the 1990s, was through the North American Free Trade Agreement, also known as NAFTA. And I want to look at just one aspect of NAFTA, and that is corn, okay? According to the World Bank, which has never been a great defender of the world's poor, they say that one of the major causes of world poverty is the $1 billion a day that industrial nations spend in subsidizing crops, as opposed to other countries that do not subsidize crops. So in the United States, during the first 10 years of NAFTA, from 1995 to 2004, the US subsidized US crops to the tune of $41.9 billion. What this means is, when we look at corn, for Mexicans, it was cheaper to buy US corn than to grow their own corn. And we need to understand that corn is, how can I say, corn was first domesticated in what is now Central America. Back during the, I mean, we have fossils of corn seeds dating back to the Stone Age. That's where corn was born. And from there, it spread up north and it spread out south and spread south. And the beauty of corn is that you could grow it anywhere. High climate, I mean, high altitude, low altitude, heavy rain, dry climate. Corn grows everywhere. And therefore, it became the food of the Western Hemisphere. Every Latin American country has its own corn dish, its own corn food. In my country, it's called harina. So we all basically have lived off the corn, so much so that in indigenous religion, it is one of the three sisters, corn, beans, and squash, become quasi, quasi divine. So here is where corn is born, but by the beginning of NAFTA, it becomes unprofitable to grow corn. And before NAFTA, the average farmer basically would grow enough corn that they could go ahead and keep a third for their livestock and themselves, sell a third on the market, on the open market, and with that be able to buy education for their children and build houses. The corn basically maintained the household. The first decade of NAFTA, corn prices in Mexico dropped by 70%. While all other essential items skyrocketed by 247%. Because if it's a free trade agreement, now you're paying US prices in Mexico. 1.7 million farmers lost their farm in those first 10 years of NAFTA. And you have to think about this. It's not 1.1 million lost farms. Each farm represents a family of 5, 6, 7 people. The price of tortilla went up 483%. So what used to provide the financial security and food for the average person was now unaffordable. So what do you do when you can no longer grow food? You move to the north, specifically the border town, where you have established maquiladoras. Those are US-owned corporations on the Mexican side of the border, where they pay minimum wages and don't have to abide by environmental standards. The average price at the time, the average salary at the time when NAFTA was implemented was close to $5 a day. So for these corporations who were paying at the time $20, $25 an hour, it was a tremendous windfall to move those corporations south of the border. And the rhetoric at the time is that the Mexicans are taking our jobs and that's why the factories are moving down there. But the truth is that in 1979, the average CEO was making about 49 times what the average assembly worker was making. Today, they make over 300 times. So the profits of moving these factories south of the border did not go to the Mexicans. There was no windfall. It went to the CEO. So once you're in the maquiladora, and I've been at these maquiladoras, and literally you could look out the window because most of the factories are on a ridge overlooking the city of Nogales. You could look out the window, see the war, and see beyond the war a McDonald's. And the pimple-faced kid working on that McDonald's makes more in 1 hour than you make in a day. This is the pull to the US of cheap labor and the push out of Mexico by the destruction of the economic base and the destruction of all these farms. So, if only we would have known this, maybe we should not have entered into NAFTA. We knew this. And here's how we knew. In 1993, 1 year before NAFTA is ratified, the GEO, the Government Accounting Office, does a study. It is designed to do a study of every major policy that the US is about to implement to determine the course of that policy. According to the GEO 1993 study of NAFTA, they said that if NAFTA is ratified, there will be an explosion of immigration. Immigrants will be crossing the Mexican border. Now, until NAFTA was ratified, immigration, the way it worked was, if I had my corn farm in Mexico, I would go up to the border, to let's say Tijuana, and I would buy the local newspaper, and in Spanish, there would be an ad, you know, we need people to pick apples in Washington State. There'll be a bus at the San Diego Catholic Church leaving at 9 a.m. tomorrow. So I would literally just cross the border. That was very easy to do. From Tijuana to the U.S., I would just cross. There was no difficulty in doing that. I would go to the parking lot, drive up to Washington State, pick apples, and with each season, I would make my way back south, picking different type of produce until I get back to San Diego, cross the border back into Mexico, and then work my own corn farm and do my own harvest, and then do the same thing the next year. So immigration was always fluid. People would enter the states and return back once the harvest was over. And the main job of the Border Patrol is to make sure everybody went back after the harvest. And this is why, if you look at the growth of Hispanic population before 1993, you don't see a major spike increase in the number of Latinx living in the United States. But the fear of massive immigration meant that the United States had to do something preemptive to prevent this from happening. So the so-called liberal Democrat at the time, Clinton, 3 months after NAFTA is ratified, implements the policy known as Operation Gatekeeper. And what Operation Gatekeeper basically was, it was an attempt to militarize the major entry points into the United States and funnel people to an area where they could literally not cross because the elements were just so severe and so hazardous. And the idea was that this would deter people from entering the United States. In fact, they called it the deterrent policy. So the idea was that it was so dangerous and so many people would die that it would deter people from entering the United States. That did not happen. People continued to enter. And what happened is once you made it into the United States, you didn't go back to Mexico. Because if you did, you may have a more difficult time being able to get back in. And not surprisingly, now Latinx make up over 20% of the population and soon will be one of the major ethnic groups in the United States. The problem is that once you militarize the border and push people to these hazardous spaces, we are at a point where today, every 4 days, 5 brown bodies perish trying to enter the United States. And let me repeat those numbers. Every 4 days, 5 people die. And yet you seldom see any news accounts about this. This is probably the greatest human rights violation going on in this country at this time. And yet, very few people talk about it. So let me pause there and answer the question, why am I here? Why did I come? Why do immigrants come to this country? And here's the punchline. So if anybody has been dozing, you might want to wake up now because this is important. When one nation builds roads into another nation, for the express purpose of stealing their raw material and their cheap labor, why should we be surprised when those people take those same roads and following everything that has been stolen from them. The reason I am in this country, and frankly, I would rather be in my own culture, speaking my own language. But the reason that I am here is I am following all the sugar, all the tobacco, and all the rum that has been stolen from my country. And here is the ethical question. When most people talk about how to respond to immigration, when most liberals and progressives talk about how to respond to immigration, the Christian response is usually, we need to practice the virtue of hospitality. These poor folks, we need to provide hospitality to them. That is wrong. Here's why. Hospitality assumes you own the house. And as long as I live by your rules, I'm welcome to stay in your house until you get tired of me and ask me to leave. But here's the thing. We built this house. It is our cheap labor and our stolen resources that built this house. And I want my damn house back. So the issue is not hospitality. The issue is really restitution. What do we owe these countries for 100 years of stealing their raw material and cheap labor and installing governments that bled them practically to the point where today they have non-functioning governments? That is really the question, the ethical question that we need to wrestle with. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you, Dr. De La Torre. Are we taking questions?
I'm open to questions.
So,
those of you who are in ceremonial hall, we have a microphone. So if you have a question, don't ask it until you have the microphone. For those of you on Zoom, you can type your question in the chat and I will read it out, or you can hit the raise hand button that we have again, and we can unmute you and you can ask your question directly.
So to get started, I have a question, and I'll take my prerogative as the presider to ask. So Dr. De La Torre, what do you think we should do now? I mean, making restitution, you said making restitution to people sounds pretty overwhelming, but if we were gonna change our immigration policy now, what is your stance? What are you recommending?
So that's a complex question, quite frankly. And let me answer it in several ways. First of all, I hesitate to give a solution to the problem. And here's why. If a spouse is in an abusive relationship, do we go to that spouse and ask them for the solution to their abuse? In other words, the way Latinx are being treated in this country is an abusive relationship. And the response is, we're not the ones that need to come up with the solution. We're not the ones who cause the problems. So that's why I hesitate to just give answers. But I will say this. I don't see this immigration crisis being solved anytime in my lifetime. The anti-Hispanic hatred that exists prevents any solutions from occurring. So in that hopeless moment that I'm living in, I would say, can we begin by at least being humane? And this is what I mean by being humane. When you pick up immigrants, and I've seen this, I've witnessed this because I spend time in the desert. Immigrants are placed in the back of vans and they've been in the desert. So they rank up the heating system in the van, and then they drive while they're being restrained, where they get injured. Women are being abused, sexually abused in the detention centers. When they are deported, women and children are being deported in the middle of the night, like 2-3 in the morning, into dangerous border towns when all the social services are closed. There is a sadistic element to this deterrent policy that's killing us. So when we say, where should we begin? What should we do? I'd just be happy if we begin with not killing us, with not putting our children into cages. I mean, think about this for a second. What is the psychological damage we're doing to these children? And when these children are 20 years old, the damage that has been caused is going to come back to bite us. So maybe rather than me talking about these tremendous great ideas of restitution and changing entire policies, for today, I'll just be happy if we could commit to be humane in our process.
Thanks. Are there any other questions here?
Sandra on Zoom, I'm going to unmute you and you can speak in a second here.
Thank you very much. It was sadly very informative. And I think the prevailing feeling in this country is NAFTA was a kind of a gift to Mexico and we lost our labor, which is true. People lost good paying jobs and how much we benefited Mexico. So it's interesting to hear a different view. I wanted to ask, I was going to ask the question that was just asked, but we hear so much that a lot of the people that are coming is from gangs and violence. And assuming that is true, what can we do in this country? How can we address something like that?
That's a good question. Let me just take a step back to your earlier, to just your side comment about the damage that NAFTA has done. No question about it, NAFTA devastated the Mexican individuals. It also devastated US individuals. The people who profited were multinational corporations. NAFTA was a windfall for them. It destroyed the US middle class, in where the average manufacturing job may have been what, $20, $25 an hour? And now we went from a manufacturing economy to a service economy that pays $7.50 an hour, even though there's a lot of push to raise it to $15 an hour. But even that $15 an hour is a lot less. So the average American has to have two jobs just to have the same amount of money income that they did when they had a manufacturing job. And think about it. If we forget about racism and sexism just for a moment, in the 1950s, without a college degree, you could get a manufacturing job at a plant and have enough money to buy a house, send your kids to college, and go on vacation. Now you need 2 and 3 jobs and you could barely afford anywhere in the country to live. And that's because we ceased being a manufacturing economy. Thanks a lot to NAFTA, which destroyed the US middle class. So I want to be clear, it's not that that Americans benefited from NAFTA, American corporations benefited from NAFTA. Mexicans and American citizens were devastated. And on the Mexican side, I'll give you an example. One of the Mexican negotiators of NAFTA owned the largest poultry farm in Mexico. And he is the one that made sure that there were no tariffs on corn so he could get his corn cheaper for his farms, increasing his wealth and destroying the Mexican farmer. So you had bad actors on both sides of the border looking to enrich themselves at the expense of individuals. But to your question on gangs, so let's look at M13, you know, one of the most notorious gangs. How did they begin? We have to go back to the 1970s during the civil wars of El Salvador. The United States provided machine guns and rifles and guns to the soldiers who were child soldiers in El Salvador and supported the government that was massacring its people, even to the point of killing Archbishop Oscar Romero at one point. So to protect US interests, business interests, we supported the Salvadorian Civil War that led to over 60,000 people being killed. And El Salvador is such a small country to begin with. Okay. A lot of the Salvadorians left their country because they were leaving the death squads that were out to kill them. Many settled in LA. While in LA, this new immigrant group faced, living in the slums of LA, faced a lot of pushback from other immigrant groups. And it was there that M13 was born, and this became a tough gang. So when immigration became a topic in 1993, a lot of these gang members were rounded up and sent back to El Salvador, and they began the gang's chapters in El Salvador that were now operating in LA. So this gang problem is US created by first supporting the child soldiers during the Salvadorian War of the 1970s, and then when they grew up, teaching them how to be gang members in Los Angeles, which then they went ahead and went back to Salvador. So yes, there are gangs. And these gangs are killing people who are trying to leave. But they're not necessarily the ones crossing the border. They have their turf in El Salvador, and they have their contacts in LA. Those who are escaping the gangs are the ones trying to enter the country. And if they are sent back and deported, they will be killed. So, I mean, I've testified in many court cases in where I made it very clear that if this person went back to El Salvador, it is a death sentence.
One second, we've got a question here. Wait for the mic, please, Ken.
Does the same thing apply to Honduras and Guatemala?
I guess it does. I spoke specifically about the gang problem in El Salvador because that's the one I've studied the most.
I can't.
I'm sorry, could you hear me? My conversation about El Salvador was the one that's the one I've done the most research in. My understanding, and I'm not an expert on Honduras or Guatemala, but my understanding that it is similar problems there. At least in talking to the Honduras people that I've spoken with and the Guatemalan immigrants that I've spoken with. But I don't have the academic knowledge of those countries as I do of El Salvador, which is the one that I've studied.
And we have one more on Zoom. Bob Berger, I'm going to unmute you in a moment.
Brian, thank you. Okay, I had trouble unmuting. Dr. El Torres, first of all, that very interesting talk. I was listening. I couldn't stop listening. But I want to take the opposite view. And that is, I'm an immigrant, or my family's an immigrant. I'm probably the first one born in this country, and I've written about it. And from Western Europe, if I didn't escape to this country, I wouldn't have had the life and a good life that I've had. And you know, I don't think you can you can blame our country for a lot of problems that the immigrants have, but I had a good run. Thank you.
No, and what you say is true, but we have to also understand even European immigrants and the one of the difference with immigrants from Latin American countries. So first, let me say that when it comes to Mexicans specifically, it's not Mexicans who are the immigrants; it's Americans who are the immigrants. It's Americans who invaded Mexico when Mexico included Colorado, Utah, California, Texas, New Mexico, and Arizona. So it's interesting. I always find it fascinating that the last people to enter this part of the country, where I'm at, I'm in Colorado, rewrite the national narrative as though they are not the problem, that they were always here. So the difference is, well, your ancestors came from Europe, my ancestors were always here. So we like to say Mexicans did not cross the borders crossed the Mexicans. One day they were in Mexico and the next day they found out they were now in the United States as second-class citizens. And also we have to realize that the immigrants who came in the early 1900s from Europe, and I'm talking specifically the Irish and the Italians and those from Slavic nations, were treated just as badly as how we are treating Latin Americans today. They were seen as not being white enough. In fact, there's an excellent book called How the Irish Became White, which I strongly recommend. And basically after the Second World War, what occurs is that the children of these immigrants who fought in the war are now given middle-class privilege. In other words, they enter into middle-class privilege. And for example, my old neighborhood, Jackson Heights, at that time, a lot of immigrants, Irish and Italian, started moving into Jackson Heights because they now were able to after the war. But until then, they were also treated horrendously. They were seen as the cause of diseases. They were seen as the cause of bringing down the nation's intellectual capacity. You know, all the same jargon were geared to them. The sad thing is that once they became white middle class, once Italians and Irish became white, they adopted that same racism towards African Americans and Latinx. So here's the danger for my group. I have light skin pigmentation. My children will probably become white, and therefore, like the Italians and the Irish before me, they could become middle class and also have a great life. But for my cousins who are Black and mulatto, biracial, doesn't matter how many generations live in this country, they will always be treated as less than because of the color of their skin. So I do want to bring in that racist element. In the Latina culture, we talk about colorism. I just want to be very clear. So yes, I also will have a great run. I mean, I'm a professor at a university. I have a nice tenure package. So I quote unquote made it. But I also have light skin pigmentation, which opened up doors for me that are not open to so many of the more indigenous and African looking Latinx that are coming. A problem that Western Europeans really did not have.
I think we have one final question on Zoom if we have time.
Okay.
Are there any particular advocacy organizations that you feel, you know, even approach a step towards some kind of restitution, and any groups whose work you really appreciate?
Yeah, I do a lot of my work in Tucson, Arizona. Specifically, I work with No More Deaths. No More Death is an organization that was partly founded by John Fife. John Fife is the one that began the sanctuary movement back in the 70s. He was arrested by the US government. He is a felon because in the church, he provided sanctuary for immigrants. he broke the law and provided them sanctuary. And the whole sanctuary movement can be traced back to Southside Presbyterian Church in Tucson. They now run what is an organization called No More Deaths, in where they literally go to the desert, and there's a tent in the desert, in where it's a medical tent, and they provide medical aid, food, and water to those crossing the borders. And I've been there many times, walking the trails, leaving behind food and water. So there's several things you could do. A, don't believe a word I'm saying, come to the border and see for yourself. No More Deaths would love to have you as a volunteer. Secondly, I also work with Border Links. That's more of an educational organization. They provide, they work with a lot of colleges and universities. They provide housing, and then they take you to some of these places so you could learn what's going on with the immigration crisis. And also Samaritan is also one of the organizations that goes out into the desert and leaves food. There are so many other organizations. The immigration movement is very decentralized for political reasons. When the sanctuary movement began, people like John Fife were like the leaders of it, and all the leaders got arrested and in jailed. And so what happens now, we're so decentralized that we don't really have a leader. So the government can't exactly arrest us for being a leader of anything. We're all volunteers. And that becomes our way of surviving the backlash from the US government for the work we're doing on immigrant rights. But yeah, by all means, I would. They all have websites, and they all have ways of connecting with them.
Thank you, Dr. De La Torre. If you could put in the chat, if you can, the names of those organizations that you mentioned, I think that would be helpful for us to find the website. Just the names of the organizations, that would be great.
Sure.
I think that we can all understand why Dr. De La Torre got these teaching awards, because he's really a great teacher. I've learned a whole lot about this, about the history of our policies toward Latin America and so forth. So I really appreciate his talk this morning, and I'm sure the rest of us do as well.